Hello everyone, so today we're going to go over the chapter review for chapter 3 part A. We're going to start by looking at some graphs of functions and seeing if we can determine what their derivatives are based on just the graphs. So if we examine this first graph on the left in example 1, we can see that there's an inflection point on the left here and a turning point in the graph on the right. At both those points, the derivative will be 0, because the tangent slope at those points will be 0. So we're going to mark that down here, 0 and 0. Now the second part of interest is that somewhere in the middle of the second interval, this part will be where the decrease is most significant. So that will result in a minimum point in our graph. Just going to go ahead and draw that in. Now, what the minimum value is, we don't know because there are no way to determine how fast the graph is decreasing. So we're going to just estimate a value somewhere around here. So, from there, you can see that the function is decreasing here, and is still decreasing in the second interval. And finally, on the right-hand side, it is increasing. So for all the intervals where the function is decreasing, the derivative, of course, will be negative. So, and then finally, on the right-hand side, when the function is increasing, its derivative will be positive. So one way to draw the sketch of a derivative would look something like this. So the second function, you can see that there are basically three parts just like the previous example. There is a part here where the slope is 0, the graph just is horizontal. Likewise, the graph here is horizontal as well. So the slopes will be 0 there. I'm going to go ahead and draw that in, slope of 0, and here a slope of 0. Now, in the middle section here, this part, the graph is increasing, especially in this middle part, at a constant rate, so we can say that the derivative is a constant value, a constant positive value, in fact. So we can probably just, we can go ahead and draw something here to indicate that the increase is constant. Finally, in between those two parts, we have an increase in the slope and then a sudden decrease, but no sharp edges, so we are going to connect these three parts of the curve, of the derivative, with a smooth curve. All right, last one. So the graph is increasing on one side, and then decreases on the right-hand side. And the graph is symmetric. And right here, we have a turning point, so its derivative would be 0. So one way to draw the sketch of a derivative, we have something that looks like this. So decreasing, sorry, positive derivative, because the slope is positive all along this first part, but it is decreasing. And then here the graph is decreasing, so we have negative derivative, and it's decreasing faster and faster. and the graph should be symmetric. So we just do our best to show that. All right, just quickly here. This middle section for the second graph should be in blue just because it is increasing. Just want to keep things consistent. All right, so that's how we can handle sketching the graph of y equals f prime of x if we're given the graphs of the functions f of x. Next up, we're going to find some limits. So this is also part of the chapter. So first one, first things first, actually, a couple of limits of that will be useful are, of course, as x approaches 0, limit of sine x over x. That we found to be 1. And of course, the limit as x approaches 0 for cosine x minus 1 over x, that was found to be 0. All right, so we're going to use those to help us find some limits in this next part. All right, so we have limit as theta approaches 0 for cosine theta minus 1 over sine theta. The first thing we're going to do is we're going to multiply both the numerator and denominator by 1 over theta. All right, so the result will be the limit as theta approaches 0. And in the numerator, now we will have cosine theta minus 1 all over theta. And this will be over in the original denominator we had sine theta. And now it will be also over theta. Now we know what the limits are in this top part. The limit here is 0. The limit here is 1. So really, if we were to try to evaluate, we will get 0 over 1. So the limit is just going to be 0. All right. In the second case, we have the limit as t approaches 0 for sine square 3t over t square. So what we're going to do here is multiply both the numerator and denominator by 3 squared. Okay, so go ahead and put those in. We'll have 3 squared, of course, is 9. So 9 sine square 3t. Now we have in the denominator t squared times 3 squared. So one way to write that, of course, is to write it as the square of the product of 3 and t. So 3t squared, like so. Next up, we're going to use the constant rule to move the 9 to the front of the limit. And then also rewrite sine square 3t. So it says sine 3t all squared, of course. And this will be over 3t squared. Which, of course, leads to limit as t approaches 0. And this whole thing will be square. So we have sine 3t over 3t. Oops. Uh-oh. There we go. Over 3t. And this whole thing will be squared, which, of course, we know this limit is going to be 1. So this should just be 1 squared. So we have 9 times 1 squared, which is just going to be 9. Alright, so the next part of the review will be the rules or differentiation that we learned. First one is just a simple application of the chain rule. So in this case, we'll have y prime will be equal to the derivative of cosine is negative sine. So negative sine and then tangent x. Of course, then we have to apply the chain rule to tangent x, and then we get secant square x. And that's it. So nice and easy one to start. Next up, you can see that this is a case where we have to apply the quotient rule. So let's go ahead and do that. So y prime is equal to 1 plus x squared. The derivative of e to the x, of course, is just e to the x. And then minus e to the x. And the derivative of 1 plus x squared, of course, is 2x. And this will be all over the square of 1 plus x squared. Alright, so you'll notice that we can factor out e to the x in the numerator, so we're going to go ahead and do that. And we will be left with, let's rearrange the terms as well. We have x squared minus 2x plus 1. After factoring out e to the x and then also rearranging the terms. And the denominator we're going to leave as 1 plus x squared squared. Alright, there's only one thing you can do really is to factor x squared minus 2x plus 1. And you'll get x minus 1 all squared. And the denominator stays the same. There's not much else to do here. So that would be a good final answer. Alright, next one looks like a quotient rule question because of the 1 over, but it's probably easier if you treat this as a power of negative 1. So we can rewrite this as y equals, and then sine x sine, sorry, minus sine x to the negative 1 power. So that way we can just use the power rule and the chain rule to find the derivative. That would be a little bit easier. So we have negative sine and then x minus sine x to the negative 2 power. And then using the chain rule, we take the derivative of the sine there. That would be cosine and then x minus sine x, which was in the inside of the original function right here. And then we still have to take the derivative of x minus sine x, and that would give us 1 minus cosine x. Alright, and then, of course, we don't want to leave our answers with negative exponents, so we're going to go ahead and rewrite this as y prime is equal to negative cosine x minus sine x, 1 minus cosine x, all over, oops, that's the wrong color. Uh-oh, there we go. Sine x minus sine x, and then this of course will be squared because of the negative 2 power there. And if you were to use the quotient rule, you can do that, and then you will get the same answer at the end. But I believe that will take a little bit longer. All right, last of the derivative examples. Actually, I wanted to rewrite this question, so I'm going to go ahead and do that right now because it's a little bit ambiguous as to what it is asking you to do. So I'm going to rewrite this as y and then the square root of x cubed times sine x. Alright, so the derivative, of course, we can just use the product rule. The derivative of the square root of x cubed. Actually, you know what? It's probably better if I rewrite this as x to the 3 halves power first before doing anything else. And now we can take the derivative y prime is equal to 3 over 2 x to the 1 half power sine x, and then plus x to the 3 halves power, and then the derivative of sine is cosine, so we have cosine x here. Alright, and then of course you can factor out x to the 1 half power, or you can rewrite it as root x, so we'll have square root of x, and then 3 over 2 sine x plus, if you factor out x to the 1 half power here, of course you would left with x, and then cosine x. Okay. And that's it. So the last question is to apply what we know about derivatives and tangents. So we're going to find the equation of the tangent to the curve y equals x squared minus 1 over x squared plus 1 at the point 0, negative 1. Alright, so you can see in this case that we are going to use the quotient rule once again. So that will be y prime is equal to x squared plus 1, and then the derivative of x squared minus 1 is 2x, and then minus x squared minus 1. The derivative of x squared plus 1 is also 2x, so that's convenient. And then it will be all over x squared plus 1 all squared. So you could simplify this expression, or you can also just substitute in 0 to find the slope of the tangent line. Either way is fine. I'm just going to go ahead and actually simplify this because it's not too complex. We're going to factor out 2x, and then what are we left with in the parentheses here? We have x squared plus 1 minus x squared minus 1. Just like that. And the denominator, of course, is the same as before, so that will still be x squared plus 1 all squared. Now you can see that this part of the derivative simplifies to be plus 2. So we will just have really 2x times 2 all over, and then we have x squared plus 1 all squared, which of course can be further simplified to 4x over x squared plus 1 all squared. Alright, so what you notice is that because we're looking for the tangent line at the point 0, negative 1, we're going to let x equal 0. Then the derivative at that point will be just, well, 0. Because we substitute 0 here and 0 here. So we have 4 times 0 over 0 plus 1 squared, which is just 0. So the tangent line then, we are going to write in Poinsot form, we have y minus y1 is equal to m, and then x minus x1 in parentheses. Y minus, and then negative 1, of course, is the y value when x equals 0. The slope is 0. And then we have x minus 0. So this all simplifies to just y plus 1 equals 0, of course, which means that the tangent line is actually just y equals to negative 1. All right. So that's what we covered in Chapter 3, Part A. And that's all we have for today. Thank you for listening.